Welcome to the series Future of Cinema, and in this series we'll be seeing a new guest each week and we'll be talking about how cinema is being evolved and the new trends and how artists and creators like us, you know, can be prepared so that we are not left behind and find practical ways, you know, to make an amazing living out of being a creator in these times. And I'm so glad to have my first guest, Mr. K. Hariharan, and he is a director of films in Hindi, Marathi and Tamil, and his first movie in Tamil, Elavadu Manidhan, won the National Film Award, and it also won the Best Film Award in Moscow International Film Festival, and he has been the dean of the film school where I studied direction. And he is also a visiting faculty in many universities in Pennsylvania and Miami. And there's lots more. And before I begin, sir, I haven't told you this, but this is the truth. You are my most favorite teacher, sir. Not in film school, right from LKG to engineering and film school, you are my most favorite teacher. And I love your class. Everyone loves your class in film school, and I loved it. Personally.
Thank you.
So thanks for coming, sir. And just a quick intro, sir. What are you doing now and what are you up to? What are you doing right now, sir? And what are you
at the moment? Okay, see, yeah. After I left the Prasad Academy, I was in search of the next step that cinema will go to. And that for me is into entering the digital world. So I left Prasad Academy because I had to understand what does digital cinema mean? What does it actually mean? So for that, I have to understand what does digital mean in the first place. So digital basically means anything which is nonlinear, anything which provides interactivity, and anything which can store artificial intelligence and work its own dialogue, work its own strategy. Okay, so you give it a certain kind of independence. So I was in search of that. And so I went to Mahindra, an engineering college first, to see if I can set up a multimedia lab there. It didn't happen there. So I went to another liberal arts college, the Ashoka University in Delhi, to see if I can work it out there. But then there it was too far. Delhi was too polluted. And then I said, let me find somebody in Chennai and write for my interest. The Kriya University opened up and called me to say, can you come and set up a media lab here and do whatever you want in the field of digital imaging and cinema. So I set up the media lab here at Kriya University with the basic purpose of taking cinema to its next step. And that is, cinema is already a virtual reality. Okay, we all know that when we see a movie, this is not really happening. It happened, but it was staged for us. So in a way, it is a virtual reality. And this virtual reality needs to go to its next step. Okay, so now I have many questions to ask myself. And some of the answers are, why did cinema start in the first place? Why did it come about in 1895 in the first place? So what was the larger purpose of cinema? So the larger purpose starts way back in the Renaissance, during the, you know, Michelangelo and Da Vinci. They were all trying to inquire, what is it that we are really watching? So if I am watching this room really like this? Or is my eye seeing it like this? So one of the first things that developed in the world of imaging was a thing called perspective. A perspective means there is a midground, a background, and a foreground. So the juxtaposition of these three grounds create a four perspective. And so everybody was trying to master perspective. But every time they mastered perspective, they saw it is happening on a 2D plane. You know, it is still two-dimensional. I'm creating an illusion of perspective, but I'm not really reaching that. So the photography, when photography came, it was almost trying to say, hey, this is the real world. because the lens is watching it. And so people started believing it, but then it's not moving. Then cinema came to say, look, it is moving also now. So now there is a word in English called verisimilitude. I must have told you in the class. Verisimilitude means that which makes the world outside look almost realistic on the screen. And cinema came with that. It almost looks as if I'm watching the real world. But then when the cut happens, when you cut, you break that illusion. Because I go from the interior to the exterior, I go from a long shot to a close-up, and it becomes virtual. Then you know, hey, this is not really happening, because in real life, I cannot cut to a long shot and a close-up and a mid-shot and a track shot. It's not possible. So cinema comes back to become the virtual reality. And then we see there are many kinds of cinema. The basic two cinemas, one was a documentary cinema and one is a fictional cinema. Whatever it is, they are both, according to me, fictional. The moment you cut, you are making fiction. Okay. So now I said, where is the cinema going to move next? So they said, okay, let's do 3D. So 3D cinema comes to say, hey, now you can actually see perspective. You can really see the foreground, midground, and background as if it is there in front of you. But still, 3D had serious problems. Why couldn't 3D become the real cinema? You see, 3D has a big problem. One is that it has a very narrow line of vision. That if you sit in a cinema theater, the best experience is somewhere at 2/3 center, where the lines perfectly meet, the two images perfectly meet and concentrate. If you are sitting on the left-hand side and the right-hand side, you don't get the right image, number one. Number two, 90% of the 3D fellows started making gimmicks out of it. You know, they all gimmicks of throwing it something at you, it flies at you and you go boom, like. And then they realize, hey, the yamatthu velai, this is not really cinema. And one of the few films that really used 3D to a brilliant extreme, and I recommend everybody to watch it, is a film called Hugo by Martin Scorsese. And that too on the life of the very great first film director, Lumiere. Lumiere's student, that was George Méliès. So it traces the life of George Méliès in Paris, the first fictional filmmaker. And I think that's the best experiment and the last experiment. So then I said, what is the problem? The problem is that we see the world all around us. But on cinema, we are watching only a square screen. The life doesn't exist in a square screen. So the only way I can manage to bring the idea of an immersive reality is through the virtual reality headset, where I can put that headset on and I can turn around, up, down, back, front, everywhere, and I am seeing cinema. I am seeing images all around me. And I think that is a great step forward. A virtual reality which allows you to immerse inside that image. So it looks like you are transported to a new world where you can see the whole thing. The moment I think like this, then immediately people will ask, but how do you tell a story? You know, how do you bring actors? How do you bring heroine and hero and fight and this? And everything is going to happen everywhere around you. Where do you focus? Do you focus the action in the front of you or something that is happening behind you? So then the problem comes that we have to break this linearity of cinema and allow the audience to interact with that cinema. So what happens is, suppose I make a film in which it is surrounding. So when I am surround cinema, like surround sound, I have surround cinema. And now I have to keep looking all around me, almost like a person who's being hunted. You know, in a forest, if you are going alone, and if you are told that somebody is going to shoot you in the forest, and you are constantly going to look around, where is this person? What is happening? So I feel that it's a good thing that cinema should now let you immerse inside a reality and make you believe that at whatever time you can watch only one segment of the world, and that is in front of you. Now that should have been a big goal of cinema right from the beginning. That make you feel that I am only watching a small portion of the world. What is above, below, side, behind, I am not able to see. And that should be the honest admission to cinema. So verisimilitude should have protected this honesty, that what I am watching is only a frame, and this frame cannot show me the whole world. Now, when I come into the world of virtual reality, you see, I must also respect what is called digitality. What is digitality? Digitality was a grand innovation that played from the linear world to the non-linear world. How do I exactly translate it for a simple audience? Let me give you the most basic example of an old typewriter. I think everybody has seen an old typewriter. You know, that when you put a paper inside and then you go typing. And when you type it and you finish four lines and you find, oh God, that first line is wrong. I should change that. What do? I throw that and bring a fresh paper, or I put black ink and change it. So that linearity was too strong of a typewriter. But the whole world communicated with typewriters at that time. And there was a shorthand person who took shorthand of that of the letter, and they kept writing in shorthand, called the Pitman shorthand manual. And then they rewrote. So it's like a typist will take notes from a shorthand of a speech, and they go. So what is happening here in this old world? There is a coding that is happening. There is a decoding that is happening. And there is an encoding that is happening. You get me? The shorthand codes that word and they decode it on another typewriter and encode it and give it back to him in order to deliver it the letter. Now, just imagine, inside this little activity is a storehouse of the next world. So what happened to the typewriter? The typewriter is now replaced by the computer. This laptop where I'm sitting in front of. What am I doing? What is common between that typewriter and this laptop? The keyboard is the same. The keyboard is the same. But now what is happening is this coding, decoding, encoding is all happening inside this. It's not happening outside. It is integrated. But what happened was something more amazing. That Pitman language, which was a kind of a scribble, now becomes a software. So when I hit M, as the software goes and hits M there, it is not a physical key. So there is a software for M. There's a software for X. Now what happens? Once this physical language becomes a software, it has multiple uses. It has a lot more value. So now I'm not just typewriting letters, but I can also now do a PowerPoint presentation. I can do an Excel sheet. I can do architectural drawings. I can design an aircraft, all with this software and on a laptop. Now you see, a typewriter, which was just used for letters, became a multiple user phenomenon. So I am trying to see, cinema should also go like this. In what happened in cinema, we had a camera in which we put a film, like a paper in a typewriter. We shot it, we coded it, then we encoded and decoded it in a laboratory. We edited it, and then we showed it linear in a cinema theater. So what happens, once that print is sent to the theater, you cannot change it because it is gone. It's a linear process. Today with digital cinema, if you say, hey, on the theater, take that four scenes out, the next screening, it is taken out. The guy who has got the original matrix of the film, he simply deletes these four scenes and gives it back to the cinema theater. The projectionist does not have to cut pieces and join it again. So you see, cinema has leaped forward in technology, but somehow making of cinema and writing of stories and telling of actors and actors and heroes and heroines has remained the same. That should have also changed, but that has not changed. So what are we doing? We are actually telling the old story. We are actually telling old stories in a slightly different way, that's all. We are not really telling a new story. We are not telling what digital cinema demands. I think that's where the problem is. We have to tell new stories. And we have to be ready to face a new dilemma. So let me tell you quickly, what am I doing now after all this? If you ask me, what are you doing now? I said, what I'm doing now is trying to repurpose virtual reality for the benefits of 100 million youngsters. What does it mean? In India today, you must know, there are 100 million children who do not get proper education. Out of that, 30 million don't go to schools at all. 30 million, you know, that's huge. It's 300 lakh students don't go to schools at all. So I am trying to say, cinema should now go for those 1 crore children. Why is it sitting behind doing only this work? So I am trying to say, how can I reach virtual reality, education through virtual reality, to the poorest child in a village? Now you will ask me, sir, how are you going to do that? That is not possible. I say, it is very much possible. You know why? Because the poor of this country have really moved forward and educated themselves on an amazing device called this mobile phone. Every poor person has one mobile phone. This is my classroom. This mobile phone will be my classroom. So today, if you go into Amazon, there is something called a Google Cardboard Box. Now, all I have to do, I have to put this into the Google Cardboard and my classroom is on. And I can go to the poorest village and give them this, tell them, give them one cardboard, which costs 50 rupees, and then put this inside and take my lessons. Now you see how many birds I am killing with one stone. One, I don't need to build schools. Two, I don't need to train new teachers. Three, I am taking to the place whenever and wherever that child finds time, she or he can learn it. More important, the parents can also start learning this. And I will deliver educational material in their own language. Now you will ask me, how many languages can you make? Yes, tell me. You're asking me a question.
Yes, sir. Ipo, the same content, you're showing the kids on a TV and you're showing it on a virtual reality box. What is the difference between these two, sir?
So what happens is, now in this virtual reality box, it has got what is called an augmented reality facility, and VR, AR. So what is augmented reality? Say, suppose there is a classroom, a lecture going on about the Mughal period, okay, and about Akbar. So where is the classroom going to happen? It will happen in Fatehpur Sikri. It will happen in Agra. So the boy is automatically sitting in Agra and learning a lesson on Akbar. What better class can you have? So he is actually watching Fatehpur Sikri all around, and the lecture is coming about Akbar established this in 1595, and then at that time he married Jodha, and then you say, hey, who is Jodha? So Jodha or photo. Now you want to know who is this Jodha. All you need to do, you know, there is something called haptic technology today by touch. So I can gaze on that and do this on Jodha's photo. And immediately I can transport myself to Rajasthan. And in Rajasthan, I am seeing, oh, this is the fort in which Jodha was born. And this is her father. This is her brother. This is her uncle. I'm going to Rajasthan. Now, suppose you don't want to know about Jodha. You want to continue further. You continue. So what have I done? I have put education, the choice of being educated, to the student. How does the student want to navigate the class? I'm sure, you know, when you are sitting in many lectures, you want to ask questions, but the lecture is going on. Like just now you asked me, how does it happen? Now, many lectures, you can't question this because it is happening uninterrupted. So, or the professor will say, you wait till the end, then ask me questions at the end of my lecture. Now, nobody is lecturing you. There is a prepared lecture. You listen to it. And wherever you find the hotspots, go and click on it and go leave the lecture and see something else and come back. Now, suppose I also give you a clipping of Jodha Akbar, this Hrithik Roshan movie. You watch that also. And you see Aishwarya Rai and Hrithik Roshan. Okay, you watch that also. Then you say, hey, I must go back. I can go back to Akbar and with the Battle of Panipat, how he fought it, how he won it. Akbar dies in 1605. So I am taking the responsibility of educating myself as a student, and you are only providing me the resources. And I think that is the best way to educate oneself, where you have a variety of choice of resources and you choose just what you want. And you feel, see, that is important, because the objective of education is not to memorize. The objective of education is to learn. If you don't learn it, what is the use of education?
Okay.
Memory, you will lose very soon. It is, after all, sitting like food inside my body, it will digest. If I eat chips today, tomorrow morning it is digested and gone. That is like memory. But if I learn it, it will stay. And how can it stay? Only if it emotionally connects with me.
And today memory is all here. So you don't...
Exactly. So what is here is not just memory. It is called information. Information is here, but knowledge is here. You see the difference?
Yeah. It comes from experience.
This cannot contain knowledge. This can contain information.
Yeah.
But knowledge is how you have absorbed it.
True.
So when information gets processed and repurposed in your brain, it becomes knowledge. But if you load information as information in your brain, you pass one exam and you've forgotten. So I'm trying to now focus on this as a very, very important educational device. See, at this moment, I can tell you something. Virtual reality has now gone high definition. Really high quality images are now available on virtual reality. But most of them are being used for games. Lots of you go shooting. I'm not saying good or bad, please. There is a market and they are selling it. So high definition virtual reality is available today. It is not my dream. High definition virtual reality is also available in another field, and it is selling like hotcakes. And that field is called pornography. There's so much of pornographic material available in virtual reality. So, and that also can happen. But I am trying to say, how can I take all this to educate people? Now, you as youngsters should think, how can I tell a story in virtual reality?
So, before we totally jump towards virtual reality, sir, I have a few questions.
Yes.
What you are doing is an effort to educate people using the resources of virtual reality.
Yes.
So, what if someone who wants to entertain people and
yes,
virtual reality?
Correct.
So, there is a big shift from the normal way of watching movies, which is the
correct
narrative structure, the storytelling, and we are moving towards virtual reality.
Correct.
So, what is this huge shift of skill learning that we have to learn to...
Yeah. Okay. I'll very simple. You see, an attempt at this kind of a storytelling has happened in one series called Black Mirror. You seen Black Mirror?
Yes, sir. Netflix. Yeah.
See, in Black Mirror, it is trying to identify this crucial area of what is happening there and what is happening here. See, when you are watching a movie, there are two things happening. One, there is a movie which is running there. Two, there is a movie which is being absorbed in your mind. And every member in the auditorium is seeing a different film in his mind. what is on the screen is common, but all of us are seeing a different film here. Okay, this is what I call darshan. Darshikaradi. The act of darshanam is what you gain from the film as an insight. What you are watching is the sight. Okay, so what virtual reality is doing is trying to give you an insight into the story. And Black Mirror is about that. There is one episode in Black Mirror in which you can actually choose the way the story wants to be told. Do you know that?
Yes.
Now, that is the first step. So you write a script which has multiple pathways. You know, every 2 minutes there is a pathway opening up. What do you want to do now? What do you want to do now? And I give you 3 options. And you choose one option and it will take you to that pathway. So can you imagine, after having gone for about 20 choices and you find, no, this is not really what I want to see. I want to go back and say, no, let me go and choose the second pathway. I go back and I choose the second pathway and move. Now what is happening is your mind is in a continuous engagement with knowledge, not information. You are engaged with knowledge. So you have to be a very skillful writer. You might actually have to write for about 20 hours of cinema to actually deliver about half an hour of cinema. Everybody. Because there are so many pathways you're opening up and everyone has different conclusions. So imagine it is like a multiplication table, you know. 2 becomes 4, 4 becomes 8, 8 becomes 16, 16 becomes 32. You get me?
Yes, sir.
That is the kind of work skill that you have to start teaching the next generation.
But do the
next
audience,
generation will have to. Yes, tell me.
But do the audience also want it, sir? Because it feels more
yes.
like I'm playing a game. Sometimes when I
yes.
watch a movie, I want to just lean back and not do anything.
Correct. So, you are right.
What happens to that choice?
Yeah. Good question. Very good question. Do the audience really want it? You know, why, if you ask me today, why are so many pictures flops? Why do so many pictures flop today?
They do not.
And I cannot imagine, because it is boring. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows the story already. Mm-hmm. And they are itching to do something with the story. You know, I'm sure you have experienced this. When you watch a movie and you say, in the scene of Portanga. You know, this scene is totally unnecessary, you know. You should have moved forward. You are already thinking like that. I am thinking like that continuously. And I can tell you, the majority of the films that I am watching on Netflix and Amazon are so bad. They are bad because we have moved forward. They have remained in the 80s. But all of us have moved forward. I have a strong feeling that audience will love this. Love to experiment with the film in which they can change the story on their own. I am sure they will enjoy it because it keeps them constantly guessing on, you know, one of the very important words we use in movies is forward movement. Is there a forward movement in your film? Now, what happens is in script writing, if you see today many, many people, many movies today, you will find that an average length of a scene is now about 20 seconds. Cut, and they go to another scene. Most of the serials have perfected that art, especially, you know, the American detective serial. So they have 5 scenes and they keep intercutting between these 5 scenes. 20 seconds here, 20 seconds, 20 seconds, 20 seconds, and back here. 20 seconds, 20 seconds, and back here. 20 seconds, like. So what happens is they are playing with your attention span. That our attention is lost after 20 seconds. Unless you have a powerful forward movement. So if you want a forward movement, then you must give the chance to the audience to move forward. Let them move the story forward. That is, for me, true democracy. I also see it as a political movement. People are now fed up with leaders. they want to take over democracy in their own hands. And I think this pandemic is going to play a very crucial role in tomorrow's cinema. Because they have seen all our leaders desperate for solutions. They don't have a vision. They don't have a way forward. And when you don't have a way forward, what do? You tell everybody to sit at home. Correct? Summa reda. You know, so many teachers in school will say, discipline, keep your mouth shut. All of us will sit like this. Today, we have come to this lockdown. Like students, we are all sitting at home with our finger on our lips. Because they don't have a solution. Doctors don't have solutions. Politicians don't have solutions. You know, industrialists don't have solutions. Research people don't have. Nobody has a solution to this problem. That really shows how education has taken such a backward step. It has not empowered us. It has not empowered us. I will tell you one thing. In 69-70, a similar pandemic happened across the world. It was called the Hong Kong flu. But during that Hong Kong flu, nobody got disturbed. Everybody was stable, doing their work, hospitals. Nobody got disturbed because they had solutions on how to run the world. One of the solutions was, at that time, a clear story was there. There are the good capitalists, the bad communists. Narrative was fixed. So we were all waiting for this narrative to play out between the good capitalists and the bad communists. And that Hollywood and everybody played that narrative. In the middle of all this pandemic of 1969, the Woodstock Festival takes place. The hippie movement is happening, in which there was zero social distancing. People were hugging each other, dancing naked, doing anything and everything. And nothing happened. People died. Yes, people died because of the flu. But this fear was not there. So now we have all been put into a state of fear. And I think people will come out of this stronger.
So there is another thing, like the
hitting. You cannot keep me afraid now.
Waiting to happen.
I think that's going to happen. And I think very strongly that the two key players in the world change, global industrial manufacturing change, will be artificial intelligence and man-machine relationships. It is already happening. You know, the way I have taken recourse to the Zoom, and I think that Zoom will support me in this communication. It's my confidence in man-machine. If I keep talking like this, and if this machine doesn't work well, what is the use? So this machine is learning from me, and I am learning from this machine. So technology now, you have to start embracing it like your brother. And use the brother also to tell its own story. We cannot be controllers. We cannot be authoritarians in filmmaking anymore. You know, there was a day when one film director will sit on the top and he'll say, everything. Give it to the audience, let them make their film. Now cinema should be like a big buffet. You provide all the items, let the audience choose whatever they want and let them eat.
So what do you think will happen to the cinema theaters, sir, after?
So what will happen is cinema theaters will become shopping complexes. That's all. All those fellows are actually, at the moment, cinema theaters are all losing money even before this pandemic started.
True.
Please, they were all losing. Inox, PVR, they were all losing money because attendance was very bad. On a Saturday, Sunday, was good attendance. The rest of the day, very bad. They were losing money left, right and center. Now they will say, let us give it to Nike and Adidas and all these films. Let them buy. Let them convert to shopping center. You know something? You are talking about cinema theater. You know what is going to happen to big organizations like TCS and Infosys? You are like nothing in front of TCS and Infosys. You know, TCS and Infosys are realizing that 80% of their employees are sitting at home and working. Now tell me, na enna enna thalaiyila molaga arichirukken, na thirupi kondu varanum office ku. Tell me, am I a fool to bring them back into the office? They nee veetle irukada. Honestly, Ajay, honestly, I am not a fool to bring them back into the office when work is going on so well. Imagine, you know, how much money TCS and Infosys were spending on transportation, especially for night shift workers. If you ever come in front of TCS office at, you know, at 12 o'clock in the night, you will see hundreds of cabs, Ola cabs leaving, you know, transporting people to their homes and bringing them back for the next shift. Now all that will stop. You'll say, sit at home and work. So you will ask, sir, what will happen to that building, TCS building, Infosys building? They'll become residential complexes. You know, the shortage of residential complexes in Tamil Nadu is so huge. We don't have a place to stay. We have to go so far away to buy one house. So now all these buildings will become residential complexes.
Then where do we go, sir? Like a lot of your students, you know, like me and everyone, we have grown up with the dream of seeing our movies in the theater, you know, making movies till we die. And that dream seems obsolete now. Where do we go from here?
So now I think it's a great opportunity now, because now fiction cinema is not your only answer. Before, we used to think there is only one cinema, and that is fictional cinema, which has to run for 1 hour and 40 minutes or 2 hours long. All that will stop. And I think it's a great opportunity to say, yeah, you want to make a promo film? Go ahead, make it. You want to, or virtual reality, you want to make a, you know, one of the biggest businesses for virtual reality today, do you know where it is used most in India?
Hospitals?
In selling flats.
Flats?
Selling houses.
Oh, okay. Real estate.
So, real estate. Yeah. So, I don't have to go to Mogapair to see this house. Yeah. I go to that fellow, he gives me virtual reality. Sir, you can actually get up and walk. Open the door, open the kitchen, close it. Everything you can do through virtual reality. You don't have to go to that house to buy that house. Imagine, you know, if it is a big 200 flat complex, you know, and there are about 12 different designs. Imagine having to walk into, spending a whole day walking through 12 different designs. Here, I can sit here. He'll send it to me at home. You don't have to go to the office also. Sir, you video karunga, naan veedu anupuren. How wonderful. Imagine you send a storyboard to your producer like this. So you use cyberspace and artificial intelligence in multiple ways.
So what the present
cinema, which we think, you know, that cinema should be like Super Deluxe, and it should be the next, you know, Bahubali. That may run parallelly. I'm not saying that should go away. But I'm saying for youngsters, you should not just focus on Jammu getting to do your next Super Deluxe.
But have you seen there is a drop down in the narrative, sir? There is more of show. Why is this happening?
Because why it is happening?
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. One observation I made.
You are absolutely correct.
TikTok has been getting so many subscribers day in and day out. யங்ஸ்டர்ஸ் மட்டும் இல்ல பெரிய ஆளுங்களும் வராங்க. அண்ட் நான் ஒரு நாள் உட்காந்து நான் பார்த்தேன் என்னதான் இதுன்னு சொல்லிட்டு ஒரு ரெண்டு அவர் உட்காந்து நான் பார்த்தேன் சார். அண்ட் ஐ ரெட் அன் ஆர்டிக்கல் விச் சேஸ் தட் தி ஏர்லியஸ்ட் ஆஃப் சினிமா விச் இஸ் த சினிமா ஆஃப் அட்ராக்ஷன்ஸ் 1906-1907 இந்த ட்ரிப் டு த மூன் அந்த மாதிரி த பியூரஸ்ட் ஃபார்ம் ஆஃப் சினிமா இஸ் தட் அண்ட் தட் இஸ் பீங் டிஸ்பிளேட் இன் டிக்டாக் பிகாஸ் இட் இஸ் மோஸ்ட்லி சைலண்ட் அண்ட் டசன்ட் ஹேவ் அ நரேட்டிவ். So Nadula vande there was this story narrative and linear structure. Now how did this change happen, sir? How did this evolution happen?
Yeah, so what happened, this is called, these are also in the technical parlance called memes. They're called memes. TikTok is a meme, which means I'm just showing one little incident of a larger framework, and you are very happy with this, that Say, suppose there is a shot of a person opening the bathroom door to go inside and brushing the teeth and coming back. That's one scene in your film. That's a meme. Now imagine if I make that itself a film. You go inside, come out, brush and see. So now people are interested in those little details now. What can you tell in a little detail of 9 seconds? So now, whatever it is, even in that, in the TikTok, what you are watching is a non-interactive version. You cannot interact with that. You cannot say, hey, what happens if this is, this door does not exist? No, that door will exist. It is still a linear story. But it is an experiment in a scene, scene development. How do I make just one scene work on its own? So that's it for me, the linguistic process, but not the story process. So there is story has a language. So this is part of the language of cinema. TikTok is part of the language of cinema. But the story of cinema now can happen in extraordinarily different ways. Extraordinarily different. You don't have to tell a story. So in design, no, in design thinking today, everybody is asking you one question. What is the purpose of your story? What is the purpose of your story? Can your story change my life? Everybody wants to know, how can this impact me? So now imagine you tell a story by which in virtual reality, there is a person who has got an amputee. You know, his hand has been amputated. And his hand is like this. Now you want to tell him, look, you know, you can actually move your hand. I will tell you a story on how to move your hand. And he says, really? You can make me move this hand? Yes, sir, I can make you. So what I do in virtual reality, I'll develop a tennis game and give you a little racket in your left hand. Your left hand is working very well. Now, I saw this. I saw the story, okay, in a university in America, in Texas. So what he has done is, every time you move your left hand, there's a tennis match happening, okay, interactive tennis match. If you move your left hand, in that image, you know, your right hand is moving. So what happened? They found by a trial that after about 10 days, this fellow is actually moving his right hand. Which was not moving at all. But I made him play a game of tennis. Now, that's the story. Can I make my viewer play a game of tennis? But tennis will add up. It's the story.
So it's become...
Is it going to be a hero, heroine? Sorry.
So storytelling is being applied to provide solution for a problem. More than...
Correct. Yeah, absolutely.
That and watching.
You are absolutely right. So, you know, I can teach mathematics like this. I can teach chemistry like this. So I'm just saying my larger goal should be, how is this story going to impact my audience? It must do a function. Give me some utility value.
You think audience won't be interested in, you know, just sitting back and watching movies like, you know, Lord of the Rings or something?
I think those days are over.
What, sir?
Sitting back and watching, no? We don't have the kind of patience which we had 20 years ago. You know, today I am seeing hundreds of people when I travel in the trains and in metros and all that. They're all watching movies on mobile phones. First of all, that film director, when he made it for the big CinemaScope screen, he never thought somebody will watch it on the very mobile phone. Mobile phone. As it is running, no, he's doing like this. He's doing fast forward. Now, I am saying, how much more interactive can it become? You did not make your film with the intention of somebody fast-forwarding it like this. But technology has made it like
this. This is a lovely point, sir. I never thought of forwarding as an interactive session till now.
It is. You know, in the old DVD player, you know, we used to skip scene.
Yeah.
We press skip. it will go to the next scene. Part one, then I skip one.
So that behavior started when VHS came itself.
Exactly, correct. Interactivity has already begun. So now you must think, how can I make my film more interactive today? And how is my story and going to anticipate even enna nenappa ipo nammale padam paathittu irukkeche, you know, we are called, hey, ivan yaar ya villain in the padathile, ivan da villain bolre, nam we are guessing when the picture is happening, the murder mystery is happening, we are wondering, ivan da, this fellow must be the crook, you know. Then I realize after 20, no, yaar, he's a nice fellow. Now what happens if I take that anticipation, ivan da crook ipo kada idu vechi padu. Come on, you make your story. I'm giving you a wide buffet. You make your story. Oh, now, you see, it can be a combination of live images. It can be a combination of animation. It can be a combination of graphics. It can be just words. Just narration. And imagine a time comes when the reader, the viewer, no, is asked to add one scene. Neengala podunga scene unga. In the padathile, you also add one scene into this.
True democracy.
So democratic. So it is like one long podcast, you know, where people can add their own voices into that podcast. I think that is why democracy came to the world.
But I don't know why I feel that, you know, all what you're saying, I can see it happening, but I somehow feel it's very long away.
I will, you know, that is because our mind is still stuck in one screenplay, you know, which is a 2-hour screenplay. First thing, throw that 2-hour screenplay out and say, I'm going to write for interactivity. So what I will advise a young filmmaker is, don't think of a 2-hour interactive session. Make a short interactive film with about 10 scenes. Just play around. Just play it and see what happens. See, beginning, middle, end, 3 scenes. Okay, now you give them 3 choices in this. So if you see 3 root, cube root 3 is 9. Shoot 9 scenes. Okay, so at every third scene, you have a choice for the next. And one more scene. Purujitha?
Yeah.
Start putting it. Start working with 9 scenes, but the viewer will see only 3. And tell me what story comes. Starting. Beginning, middle, end.
Yes.
In the format. You can start with just 3 minutes. No, sometimes I find even telling a story for 1 minute is a very difficult task today.
Okay, sir.
Because people came with that idea of seeing so much story. Okay, today there is nobody who can write on Panama Pasama. This is just hot story, hard story, you know. Because we have lost our relations. First of all, we have lost our relations.
But
we have lost our family. We have lost our connections. So what story can we tell? We can tell story only which is technology oriented, gimmicks.
But isn't that you know, the saying or the thought that, you know, stories is what binds people together.
Ah, right.
And the
KPN, that is what that is what the producer will like to believe. Nalla kada kondu vaanga. Avan nalla kada na is thinking how many songs will. First of all, if you say, sir, song e mudiyadha na poda kiluvaanga.
Na adha andha maadhiri solla sir, like I read in the book Sapiens. He's saying that gossip is a form of story. You know, that is what has kept the humans, you know, together.
Correct.
Matter. So that is a basic element. How will that go missing?
So that curiosity, you know, the curiosity of what happens next is what gossip is all about. Gossip is thriving on this germ virus called curiosity.
Okay.
So how can I make you more curious about what I'm going to say next? So my script should always be hiding something. And idukkuvendi, you don't have to find a better master than Hitchcock. You just watch Hitchcock. அவர் கதை முதலே சொல்லி இவன் தான் கொலைகாரன்னு சொல்லிடுவான். ஆனா ஏன் அவனை கொலை பண்ணாதான், யூ ஹட் வெயிட் ஃபார் 90 மினிட்ஸ் டு ஃபைண்ட் அவுட். ஆர் ஹி வில் டெல் த கில்லர் இன் தி லாஸ்ட் சீன். பட் வை தட் கியூரியாசிட்டி வாஸ் வாட் ஹிச்காக் வர்க்ட் அபவுட். கண்டினியூஸ்லி ஆஸ்கிங், இதுக்கப்புறம் என்ன நடக்கும், என்ன நடக்கலாம். ஒரு இஃப் யூ சீ எ ஃபிலிம் லைக் ரேர் விண்டோ, இட்ஸ் அ கிளாசிக், யூ நோ, டு கீப் தி ஆடியன்ஸ் continuously guessing what will happen next. So it's Rear Window is like a gossip movie. It's structured like a gossip. There is one man and he's watching 10 different people in the other building. And there is one murder happening. Any of the 10 could be doing that murder now. And I'm wondering who could have been responsible for this murder. Because I keep on distracting you. And I keep bringing back to your gossip. So how do you work gossip as a great format? That is curiosity. So that is number structure. The variety has to be done in that. Chale. Yeah.
So if we take the same Rear Window story and make it now in an interactive format, you know, we make the hero choose which door do you want to go to, which door do you want to peep into.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. No, it can be a little more tough than that. For example, you know, I come to a point and I, you know, I have to hold a gun to somebody and I say, don't tell me, I'm going to kill you. Now, you want to give a choice. You want to kill him and then go further, or you want to let him go find the way for you, or do you want to make peace with this fellow? Now, I have to make a choice. And I say, kill him. And I shoot him. Now, I have to go find that person. There must be curious. இதுக்கு அடுத்து எப்படி பண்ண போறான், அந்த எடு எப்படி பண்ண போறான், அந்த கதை தான். Now what happens when you do a linear story, I somehow figure out by the half an hour of the film as to what is happening. Or worse, you know, technology allows me to go to the last scene and see what has happened. அப்படியே skip பண்ணி லாஸ்ட் போயிடுவேன். இவன் தான் கொலைகாரன் போறேன்.
It's like you can't
the process.
You can't fast forward a painting, but movies you
can. You cannot fast forward this film because I am stopping you, tasking you to make choice.
Yeah.
You cannot fast forward this film.
No.
If you skip, you don't know what has happened. So that the choice is very, very important. It is like you have got into this bus now, and this bus suddenly you realize you have to find the next stop. You can get off this bus and move to the next bus. That is the immediacy it must work with. If you work that, I'm not saying I am a master of that screenplay writing. Please don't ever think like that. But I think if we put our heads into it, bring Hitchcock to modern day technology.
Amazing tip, sir.
That is the key to the solution here. How can I bring Rear Window today in today's cinema? முதல்லே 10 choice கொடுக்கிறார் அவர். இந்த 10 கதையை நான் எப்படி வச்சு பண்ணலாம்? You know, that is the key to this film. The next range of filmmaking. நான் என்ன பார்க்குறேன், அதுக்குள்ள அது மாதிரி பண்றது போல, I'm at this my age, I think I would rather do education. It is a safer bet. இதுல காசு வரும். If I go to education department and I say, sir, can I make a history textbook for you in virtual reality and give the student this headphone? Anyway, they are going to sit at home and learn. Instead of doing online learning, give the online content in this. I can tell the Chola history on this. And I can give multiple endings, multiple ways of moving to other scenes and all that. Purujitha?
Yeah.
Education will start. Modalla history, sarithram solluvom. Let us tell history first. And from there, we will find ways and means of negotiating fiction. See, the first films were all historical films. What did Lumiere Brothers do? They just shot people arriving at station, attending conference, eating breakfast, watering garden. I will tell you what I am doing. I am applying to the government of Orissa through a funding agency to make educational kits for 3 lakh tribal children in Odisha. எப்படி சார் எனக்கு ஒடியா தெரியாது சார் பரவாயில்ல ஐ டோன்ட் நீட் ஒடியா பட் ஐ ஹாவ் அ சாஃப்ட்வேர் கால்ட் அலெக்சா அலெக்சா டாக்ஸ் டு மீ நான் என்ன பண்ணுவேன் இப்போ ஐ வில் ஃபைண்ட் ஒன் சாஃப்ட்வேர் விச் வில் டிரான்ஸ்லேட் மை இங்கிலீஷ் இன்டு ஒடியா சிரி இருக்குல்ல சிரி சாஃப்ட்வேர் கேன் டிரான்ஸ்லேட் இன்டு லாங்குவேஜஸ் ஐ ஹவ் டு ஒன்லி கிவ் த டிக்ஷன் டு இட் ஸோ ஐ வில் கிவ் மை ஹெட்ஃபோன் மை virtual reality and one Alexa to this tribal boy in Orissa. And he can ask questions and that Alexa will answer in Odia.
Amazing.
You see, what is the most important thing that artificial intelligence is teaching me is that this is information. It cannot become knowledge. Knowledge happens only when you question this information. So I will question Alexa. And Alexa will find that information for me and I will make knowledge here. I think that is the revolution that is going to happen. And when I look at this with the simple statistics I gave you, 10 crores children who don't go through proper education. What better impact can I have? Ajay, நீ நினைச்சு பாரு இன்னொரு 10 வருஷத்துல இந்த 10 கோடி வருவான் தெருவில் வருவான் இன்னைக்கு மைக்ரண்ட் லேபர் கஷ்டப்பட்டு இருக்கான் இவன் ஸ்கூலே போனது கிடையாது இவன் என்ன செய்வான் என்ன வேலை செய்வான் ஐ திங்க் தெர் இஸ் அ இமீடியட் அர்ஜென்சி நவ் டு அட்ரஸ் தட் பாய் பிகாஸ் நவ் இஃப் யூ சே நோ நோ யூ லேர்ன் அல்ஜிப்ரா கெமிஸ்ட்ரி மேத்தமேட்டிக் ஹிஸ்டரி அவன் போடாது இதெல்லாம் படிச்சு யூஸே இல்லை யூ ஆர் ரைட் ஹீஸ் ரைட் இந்த கிளாஸ் ரூம்ல டெக்ஸ்ட் புக் படிச்சு ஒண்ணுமே ஞாபகம் இல்லாம என்ன யூஸ் அது ஸோ த டைம் ஹஸ் கம் டு லெட் எவ்ரி இண்டிவிஜுவல் எஜுகேட் ஹர் செல்ஃப் ஆர் ஹிம் செல்ஃப் தட் இஸ் த வே டு மூவ் ஃபார்வர்ட் இஸ்ன்ட் இட் That is the way to move forward.
So, I don't know, sir.
It's a tough challenge. It's a very tough challenge.
Yeah.
You know, but I'll tell you something, Ajay. Mm. All this time I was talking to you, I did not realize one very important thing.
What, sir?
It shows how I am so old. I have not connected this to the computer. This is hanging. இப்பதான் பாக்குறேன். அட பாவி, I am hearing you from here and you are listening to my voice directly. Okay. See how wonderful this is, learning. Now let me just try it. I will put this inside.
Okay.
And we will see how technology has changed. Now can you speak to me?
Yes, sir.
Can you hear me now? Yeah. The voice is so different.
It's actually lower, sir. It's good that you didn't connect it. It was better.
Oh, really? Okay, yeah. Thank you. Okay. But I can hear your voice better here, but oh. You can't hear my voice. No. Yeah. This is learning. This is knowledge. This is knowledge. And I don't know what book you have to do. The fellow who sold me this would not tell me that this voice will become lesser because of this.
Yeah.
Now, this is knowledge.
Mm.
So I think that is the greatest part of learning, you know. I have learned something on my own, which a manual will not teach. So I think we have to get prepared for this new world. You know? On every day, there is going to be a new reality opening up. And we should be ready on a daily basis to face an unpredictable world. And I think that's a great way to move forward, you know. Cinema is too predictable today. World outside is unpredictable. So how am I going to help my audience to face an unpredictable world?
So before
that is the story for today.
So this before we end this amazing interview, and the last question, sir, for your students, you know, sir, how do we make money out of it, sir? It's a very blunt question. I feel it's needed because.
Absolutely. So how do you make money? You should go to place where there is money. First rule. Mm. If you want to get money, you have to go to a bank. Mm. You cannot go to Avin Milk Depot, get money. Mm. You have to go to a bank. Mm. So today, the two biggest sectors, which is going to receive a lot of money, is education and healthcare. These are the two areas where everybody is going to put money for tomorrow. Education and healthcare. Now, you have to be intelligent to say, what kind of script am I going to write for education? You know something, cinema has been the greatest educator for 90% of India. இன்னைக்கு வந்து அஜய் நீ வந்து ரெண்டு வார்த்தை ஹிந்தி பேசுவேனா, இட் இஸ் பிகாஸ் யூ saw ஹிந்தி films.
Totally true.
You see, nobody taught you Hindi, but you saw Hindi films and you learned. Now, I think that is education. If you have seen New York, it is thanks to cinema. If you have seen Antarctica, it is thanks to cinema. Cinema has educated you. Our educator varala. You see, if wildlife authorities, you know, World Wildlife Fund should thank one man called Chinnappa Devar. Evlo kadha yane vechi panninaar paaru avaru.
Yeah.
Imagine somebody living in Bihar, somebody living in, you know, in some remote village in Rajasthan, and the kondai tepe ni yane paathirikkiya na sonnena, I have seen haathi mere saathi nu solluvan. And the kondai yane vandu devar padathula dhaan paathirukku. It is education. So please don't think that we have not been educating people. We have been educating them very well. Now we have to become conscious of the fact that we are actually educated. So na enna solluven inniki vandu even your answer, direct answer, how do I make money, is in two fields, education and healthcare. Ena you will get two satisfaction. One, a, you make money, and two, the beneficiaries are plenty people. If you work on a one feature film, ultimately film flops and 2000 people have seen your film, what is the use of having worked so hard? 2000 பேரும் படத்தை பார்த்தானா என்ன யூஸ்? It is of absolutely no use. Democracy demands that you appeal to the maximum number of people. So every youngster must think like that. இந்த கதையை வந்து நான் எப்படி ஒரு 10 லட்சத்து பேர் சேர்த்தலாம்? And you have to be realistic. So if you want me one line motto, ennoda life oda one line kurikol enna na, dream big but think real. Dream big but think real. 10 lakh pe sethanona po education program pannu, adhu nee entertaining a pannu, make it entertaining. Tell the story of Rajaraja Chola in the most entertaining way possible.
That's
what I would say.
When you say education, you're still talking about narratives.
I'm telling anything is a narrative, anything is a story.
Okay.
Education is also a story. Mm-hmm. As long as you can drive the curiosity of your audience, mm-hmm. you're telling a great story.
Oh, is your story educating the audience?
Correct.
That's the question you have to ask.
You can tell a fictional story. You can make a fiction.
Okay.
And tell the story of Rajaraja Chola.
Okay.
You can tell a complete fictional story. If you see my Dubhashi, mm-hmm. it's a story. But what is it educating? That children must learn more languages.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the story. And today many, many schools are showing it as encouraging children to pick up many more languages. Okay. Educational film. But I told a story, a fictional story. So think like that. Think like that. And I'm sure a young generation, if they put their positive mind, mukkiyama vandu na yaarukku kaatta poren idu. Yaar idu program vechi benefit panna poren. Empathize with the audience first. And select a big catchment area. Empathize with them and tell a story. And don't think telling a factual story, documentary is a bad thing. No, apdi solalam. Adu simple a irukku. It's a simple story to make, but try saying that first. Can you tell me a simple story in 25 minutes about Mahabalipuram? Panikami. Adu interesting panniyana, then your next step, make a fiction on Mahabalipuram. You know, in the panchara, the big wall, regular Arjuna's penance. Come on, make a feature film on, make a story film on that. A 20-minute film on Arjuna's penance. And do it in virtual reality. Do it in interactivity. Make me curious. Why is Arjuna standing in penance? That is only. Oh, there are so many ways of opening up stories, I can tell you. And you should never lose heart. You should say, hey, I dream big, but I think real.
Sir, I think that's an amazing quote to end this amazing interview. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I express my gratitude. My first episode being on this, Romba, thanks. It felt like being in film school again, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You know what is the poster behind me? It is written in Bengali, of course.
Uh-huh. Illa, sir.
In the which Bengali film I love so much.
Ayayo.
And whenever I show it in the class, I end up crying at the end of this. Enda pada?
Is it Ghatak's movie?
Ah, correct, correct. Enda pada?
I don't remember the name, but it's about a woman and some flight of... Actually, I missed watching that screen and everyone came out and said, you should have seen Hari sir crying. Chance illa.
அதான் ஹைலைட் ஆயிடுது. இந்த அவளோட தொடர் கதை இருக்கு இல்ல, it is lightly taken from this film.
Okay.
Of a sacrificing elder sister, you know.
Yeah. It's like, even before the screening, they told that, you know, Hari sir is going to cry in this movie. It's like a LVP. Everyone knows.
The film is called Megha Dhaketara.
Megha Dhaketara.
Mega Dagatara. Three people. See that film. Brilliant, brilliant film. Absolutely.
Sure, sir.